Welcome. Having coffee with Cullotta again. I want to thank all 550 subscribers that are tuning into YouTube to see me. I'm going to try and answer all your questions. I hope you enjoy this segment. There's certain questions I'm not going to be able to answer, but I'm going to try. Don't forget, having coffee with Cullotta, subscribe. Thank you again. Howard, you asked me about the tours that take place in Vegas that I have, and there's also another company that does them, and the guy, I call it my sister company. It's actually his company. My tours are private personal tours that you ride with me in my vehicle, or I rent a vehicle. Depends on how many people that is in your group. I charge $500 a couple. I don't care if it's two guys, two women. Or, you know, it don't make no difference. Now, if you're single-o and there's only one person, you want to go on my tour, I'm going to charge you $350. And I don't take credit cards or personal checks. They may bounce, but then I got to come looking for you. Credit cards, they make enough money on these credit cards. So I prefer the cash. If you want to do my personal private tour, look at the screen. You're going to see my personal private tour number. 9 times out of 10, I answer the phone. Lately, I haven't been answering the phone a lot because I've been a little sick, so I've been canceling a lot of tours. Hopefully, next month, I'll be good so I could continue doing the tours because I like to socialize with people, and I talk about the movie Casino, where some killings were done, and so on and et cetera. People go to TripAdvisor to find out more about me. I got over 161 5-stars. A lot of people say, people are scared to give you any less. No, I don't think so. I enjoy the tour. Now, there's another tour in town. The guy's a real great guy, and he's got a good tour. And he's got videos up there, and it's about me. I talked through the whole thing, too. And he could take, like, 13 people. It's a lot cheaper, and it's well worth the money. I think it's $100 a head. And that's, I mean, you can't beat that price. It's like 2.5-hour tour. And he offers other things, like a Rat Pack show where you can see these pretenders, the Rat Pack. And he offers pizza at the end of the tour. I mean, you get a lot for a C-note. If you can't afford $100, then stay home. Don't come to Vegas. All right? And then look at the phone number on the screen. You see it? Write that number down. Now you got two phone numbers. Remember, mine's a little bit more expensive, but don't forget, it's with me alone. The other one? It's got all about me, and he talks about a lot of things. He also has another tour, this other company. It's about ghost tours. Now, you'll find all that out if you go to that number, you know. So that's the best I can tell you there. There's no other tours in town that do the job that we do. I've been asked about Frankie Schweihs, the German. Yes, of course I know him. Him and Tony were very good friends. Both of them work for Milwaukee Phil, of the Riccio. That's how I first met Frankie Schweihs. I met him several times. I never done anything with him because he was a kook. That's what they call him, the kook. He didn't like anybody. Really, he didn't like anybody. He was that's just the way he was. He was a cold-blooded killer, I come to find out later. And the first time I met him and Tony on the South Side. Tony and I drove up there to meet him, and they had to meet Milwaukee Phil. And we talked a little bit, and actually, I didn't even shake the guy's hand. I looked at him, he looked at me, and we ignored each other. The next time I met him, it was in a suburb in Elmwood Park. It was a friend of mine, Richard Gorman. We call him Dickie Gorman. It was in his apartment, and I went over there to meet Tony and Dickie Gorman. And when I walked in, this same guy that was with Tony months before was with them in this apartment. And I went to shake his hand, and he turned his head. He ignored me. And Tony yelled at him, what the fuck's the matter with you? Shake his hand. You met him before. Well, Schweihs, you know, looked at me, and I looked at him. And he stuck his hand out, and I didn't shake his hand. Tony said, what, are you going to play like him? I said, I don't even know this guy. I don't even want to talk to him. So I did my business with Tony and Richard Dickey, and I left. The next time I met him was in Florida. I went out there, we're going to do a robbery out there. So I went out there and I was sitting at the bar with some broad, and he was sitting at the other end of the bar, and another associate of mine was in there, Joey Hansen, another hitman. And Joey yelled, "Frankie," and we, you know, talked on that bullshit. And then Frankie Schweihs, I couldn't believe it, he walked over and shook my hand at the bar. And we talked a little bit, just, you know, bullshit talk, nothing of any importance. And there was a few times I met him after that, didn't say too much because the guy didn't talk a lot. And then one time Tony told me a story when they got busted, or Frank got busted, he was dressed like a broad. They were going to go get somebody and break his head. And Frankie Schweihs dressed as a female. And I told Tony, I said, "What kind of guy would dress like a woman?" I said, he said, "Well, you know, the guy's a kook. That's the only way we could get the guy." He says, "Well, Frankie got busted. Somebody seen him out there." So that was the last time. So that's about all I know about him. I did hear that he killed his girlfriend. I don't know that for a fact, but I heard he killed her in Truman Lake, Michigan. It's probably true, but I don't know it for a fact. This is what I really know about Frankie Schweihs. He was the kind of guy you didn't want to be around. He was very uncomfortable to be around. There was only one other guy I thought was more difficult than Frankie Schweihs, and that was Larry Neumann. I guess if you put them both in a room with chainsaws, I don't know who would come out. I think Larry would come out ahead. He would come out ahead. Larry Neumann. And that's basically it about Frankie Schweihs. Now, people have asked me, again, about Joe Lombardo. I think they're fascinated with Joe. How much more I knew about him. Well, I think I said everything I did know about him. And he was a strange guy in his own way. He never came out of that neighborhood. I'll tell you the honest thing, I never seen Joey in a suit. I never seen him wear a suit. He always dressed very casual, with a cap on his head and smoking a cigarette. I actually never even seen him drink. I know he was married. I know he had children. You never seen his wife. They lived in the old neighborhood off of Grand Avenue. And that's where he stood. He stood in that area all the time. If you seen him out of that area, it was for business. Now, you know, like I said, I stole with Joey. I did some crimes with him. I also know that a couple murders that he'd done, I was told that one that him and Tony and Richard Gorman done, I think Saint was on it too. It's in one of my books. Now, did he tell me? No. I think Tony mentioned it to me, Spilotro. So Joe would do the job. If he needed to do the job, he would do the job. He didn't have to go to anybody. And then as time went on, as he got older and more involved and more senior ranking, of course, now they got guys that would do that for them. He'd just get a guy, and the guy would go and do it, or two, three guys, whatever it was. You know, if it was a hit, let's put it like that. I don't ever remember him telling anybody where to go rob things or anything like that. That's not his bag. So that's basically about Joe Lombardo. Gino, I think you were the one that answered me that question. I hope I helped you out there, but I'm not going to exaggerate on these stories or anything. I'm going to tell you exactly what I know. Did I ever have a drink with him? I know I had a drink. I don't remember if he had a drink in his hand. At a neighborhood bar, you know, they had bars on the side streets, their taverns. And it was just a social drink. Have I ever seen him in card rooms? Yeah, he used to go around to the card games. They always had card games in that neighborhood. You know, they take money out of the card games. And Joe was there in case, say, you were busted out and you needed $1,000, he'd give you the money on juice. So that was one of their functions, one of his deals. When he was younger, you know, as he was working his way up the ladder, let's put it like that. But Joey was always connected. As long as I know him, he had some way or another that he was connected to the Chicago office. And then as time went on, he got bigger and bigger and bigger. Danny, I'm going to ask you asked me a question about Tony Spilotro, whether he was really tough with his hands. Well, yeah, he was when we were kids. Tony was remarkably quick with his fist. and he hit very hard. Now, most guys, little guys, are usually very tough because they, you know, they have to prove something. But I've seen Tony whip a lot of guys with his hands. One particular time, I'll never forget it, he was in the back room of this lounge, and there was five guys that were playing poker in the back room or something. I know they were playing cards. And I was sitting at the bar with a couple other guys. It was a lounge that was owned by the outfit. And I heard hollering and screaming. And then I seen this big guy come out of the back room. I mean, he was a big guy. He was about 6 foot. And he was probably about 220, 230. And Tony and him were arguing. And everybody else came out of the car room too at this, about the same time. And all of a sudden, Tony, I think it was like 5-6 shots, punches. He had to jump up in the air and hit this guy. I mean, they were quick. And he hit this guy all in the eyes and the nose. And the guy went down to his knees. And I looked, I said, Jesus Christ. And the guy was trying to hold Tony's hands. And Tony ripped one hand away. And I know what he was doing, what he was going to do. And Tony went behind his back and his waistband. He had a 38. And I jumped off the stool, missed straight shit. And I grabbed his hand. I said, what are you fucking kidding? It ain't worth it. And I took the gun from him. And the guy told him, man, I can't believe a little guy like you whipped me like that. He said, I love you, brother. I love you. He's giving all that bullshit. And Tony looking at him like, this guy's weird. You know, the guy's eyes were instantly closed from the punches and blood was coming out of his nose and mouth. And then the guy got up and he wanted to hug Tony and kiss Tony on the cheek. And that was basically it. The guy left the place a bloody mess. Tony went in the back room and continued playing cards. And there was a few other times I seen him have fights with guys when we were younger. And he always won because he was, like I said, really quick with his hands and he hit really hard. So I knew he could handle himself. I seen him do it in the Mark 7 in Elmwood Park one time with some hillbilly guy. He knocked the shit out of him too at the bar. And Johnny DeFranza was there that day, and so was Joey Anciaracchi, Joe the Builder, Big Joe. And I heard Joe say, man, that kid could really punch, meaning Tony. And I started laughing at myself. So Tony knew how to, he did not handle himself in public. Remember that. Having coffee with Cullotta. I'll return shortly. Enjoy yourself. Hit that button. Prescribe.